Welcome back to the GCN Tech Clinic, where we help answer and solve your bike problems so that you can get back out on your bike again, riding and enjoying the sunshine. Or the rain, depending where you come from. Anyway, let's start then, shall we, with the first question this week. And that is from Anton Lipnivsteft, who says, "Dear John, it's me again with the question, can I use Force 1 levers with an XX1 rear derailleur?" Now, hi Anton, I actually like your idea here, a little bit of a hack or a bodge to do something, I don't know what. Sadly though, you cannot, because the Rode 1x11 components use an exact actuation cable pull ratio, and the mountain bike version uses an X actuation cable pull. So I'm afraid there are two different amounts of cable being pulled there from the actual gear lever itself. So that hack or bodge that you were planning is not going to work, I'm afraid. Next up is a question from Liam Zangaku, who is a very popular commenter on the videos. Now, Liam asks, should I grease my quick release skewers? Will it allow my wheels to roll smoother? Right then, Liam. So if you were to grease your quick release skewers, I'm afraid it won't make any difference to the actual rolling resistance of your bicycle. The reason being, nothing actually turns on them per se, because all they're doing is a very important job, but what they are doing is actually holding the axle in place into your dropouts. And then in turn, the actual hub bearings are turning on that axle. Now, a way in which you could possibly apply some grease to those quick release skewers for benefit is to actually try and reduce any creaking or clicking, because in the past that has been known to cause a few problems there. But if you want to make sure that your wheels are rolling smoother, basically you're gonna have to look at the bearings. That's where the rolling resistance differences are gonna come from. Now we've got a question from VeloBar Plus, who asks, my rear wheel has a DT Swiss hub on which I can change the end caps. Now I use a 5mm quick release axles. If I were to change the end caps to use 10x135 quick release axle, would it still fit in the frame? Right, so just let everybody know out there, those DT Swiss hubs, basically you can change those end caps so that they're compatible on different styles or different widths of frames. So it's a really, really versatile hub. Now, without knowing the exact model of that hub that you've got, I'm afraid I can't answer that question. But essentially, I don't see a problem with you actually being able to do that at all, providing, of course, that your hub is able to accommodate that 10mm axle. Now we've got a question from Greg Brown, who asks, what's the best way to clean brake tracks of carbon wheel sets? Not just road grit and grime, I think they mean, but brake pad residue. Right, Greg, well, you are gonna need some of that good old fashioned John Canning's elbow grease, which people have asked in the past where they can buy it from, but I'm afraid it's not for sale. The best thing to do here is get yourself a bucket of warm soapy water, remove the wheels from the actual bicycle itself, and then with a sponge, simply apply a decent amount of pressure onto the brake tracks of the rims to remove any of that residue. There's no easier method, not that I know of, certainly. And whilst you're at it as well, actually clean out those brake pads too, because sometimes they can get a little bit gummed up with road grime, and also some of those compounds of brake pads do actually melt down a little bit, and sometimes they can block up the grooves that are inside of the brakes. Next up, we have a question from Marwan KMS, and I love this one. I don't know if I must use Ask GCN Tech or hack or bodge. Well, just use Ask GCN Tech, then I'll be able to help out. But I'm quite tempted to tape my helmet vents to get some aero gains. I know some rider did it in a time trial a few years ago, and some triathletes are doing it too. Is it UCI legal? What are my thoughts about it? Yes, the old taping up vents trick. Well, I'm afraid it's not allowed by the UCI. There's actually a rule against that. So there we are. It could mean you would get a little bit hot-headed if you were to tape up those vents, but more importantly, you could land yourself in hot water too if the UCI were to catch you. Now, I actually tried to make a helmet cover about 6 or 7 years ago now using some fiberglass, and embarrassingly, the results are on screen right now. It wasn't a particularly good effort, I must say, but hey, I had some spare time on my hands, so I thought I'd do it. And I actually never used it in a race either, so it was basically a Saturday afternoon, not very well spent. But yeah, you cannot do that if you are gonna race in a UCI race. Now, Shiram S asks, awesome show, daily viewer. Wow, what's not to love about that? What do I need to upgrade from Ultegra Mechanical to Ultegra Di2? My bike manual says it's Di2 compatible. Right, well, you are gonna need Di2 levers, Di2 cables, a battery, a junction box. Get yourself a charger too, that's pretty important. Now, I made the change to Di2 many, many years ago, and I've never looked back since. Absolutely love it, so good luck with that one. Next up is a question from John Rogers, who asks, basically they're following up to a speed sensor question a few weeks back. Do you really need one at all? Is speed from GPS as accurate? They had one before, and now they don't, and their Garmin still reads speed. Right then, John, well, you don't need one per se, because you're right, you know, your GPS unit is obviously a GPS and it can track your speed. However, sometimes accuracy is not as good as it could be, particularly if you're riding under thick tree cover or around tall buildings or even through a tunnel, because obviously in a tunnel, you're not going to be able to see those satellites with your head unit. So just bear that in mind. And then interestingly, if you have a non-direct drive style turbo trainer, you could attach that speed sensor onto your rear hub, allowing you basically a cheap way into Zwift. So there we go. Next up is a tire question from Lee350. Is it okay to run a 25 tire up front and a 28 at the rear? I will soon be replacing my rear tire and would like to try a 28, but don't need to replace the front yet. Hello Lee, 25s, 28s, what are you, a touring cyclist or a mountain biker? I jest. These width tyres basically have become super popular over the last few years, and indeed you can run a 28 on the back and a 25 on the front, no problem at all. This is actually something which I do in the winter. Just bear in mind though that you do need to make sure you've got enough clearance with your brake caliper as well as your frame to run a 28 millimeter tire. Recently, I did try and fit a 28 millimeter tire into a fairly recent racing frame, only something which is 3 or 4 years old, and it wouldn't clear. So there we are, just bear that in mind. But hopefully you'll be good to go and get a little bit of extra comfort. Next up is a question from Cyprian, who asks, how do I true my tubular wheel which has inside nipples? Cyprian, the art of wheel truing, something which can sometimes go horribly wrong. It certainly did for me the first time I ever tried. I was 14 years old, and basically I destroyed a wheel. When my dad got home from work, I'm surprised he didn't kill me, because yeah, I wrote off a perfectly good wheel. Anyway, I will explain the basics of this. You are going to need to remove that tubular tire, which possibly you had to wrestle on in the first place, and maybe get a little bit of glue. In my case, I used to get it everywhere. Now, then you are going to need to find the offending spoke, or however many there are. And then basically, you're going to need something like this, which is a spoke key, but it's different to what we normally find. This one has got four sides inside of it. And basically, that will attach then onto an inverted spoke nipple in some cases that you simply tighten or loosen. Now, it's not always four-sided. Sometimes it can be a hex shape. It all depends on what type of wheel you've got. If you're totally unsure, I would advise visiting your local bike shop, who will certainly be able to help you out with any sort of wheel building or wheel truing problems you may have, because it's not that easy, believe me. Next up, we've got a question from Toasty Bear, who does like to write into us with a technical question. Now, Toasty says they took apart jockey wheels on a fairly low-end Shimano system as they were feeling a bit sluggish. They admit then it was actually off a mountain bike, so they could have asked Doddy for help, but they've come to me. That's always nice. Only to discover there's no bearings inside. It simply rotates under a metal cap. Is it common? Does it really make that little difference? And if so, can I just buy replacement jockey wheels as an upgrade? Right then, Toasty. So, just to clarify, some jockey wheels or pulley wheels do come with cartridge bearings fitted, whereas others resemble what you've just talked about there. So it's simply a bush which goes inside the center of the pulley wheel, and then has some metal caps and then attaches into the derailleur cage. Now on yours, sometimes they can get a little bit gunked up with road grime and oil, that sort of thing, but they're pretty simple to clean. So you just simply pop them out, give them a quick rub down, add a touch of lubricant before reassembling and then putting back into the bike. Whereas the cartridge bearings, well, they're not really that easy to service, but they do offer performance gains. That's why we tend to find them on the higher end components. Now, you ask me if you can in fact buy a replacement. You can. A cartridge bearing jockey wheel or pulley wheel will fit exactly the same way in which the current one you have does. So it's really a case of if you want to spend that little bit extra to have a little bit of a marginal gain. Final question this week is from Mark Averson, who asks that, well, basically they're telling me they're looking to keep gradually updating the drivetrain. They've got Ortega 6800 rear cassette and a long stroke medium cage derailleur. Can they use Dura-Ace 9100 semi-compact with it, plus Ultegra 8000 front derailleur? Sounds like a bit of a bodge, but the 8000 front derailleur is much cheaper than Dura-Ace for a similar spec. Oh, and I've upgraded the levers to Ultegra 9070. Cheers. Hi, Mark. Yes, you can. So go out there and enjoy the ride. Now, I hope that you've enjoyed this week's GCN Tech Clinic. Remember to leave me your technical questions, problems and queries, anything which is preventing you from riding, or maybe you're thinking about a cheeky little upgrade, leave them down there in the comment section for me. And remember as well to like and share this video with your friends. Give it a big thumbs up. Share it with a friend if they've got one of those problems we've just tackled. Hopefully they won't have an excuse anymore. Now, remember as well to check out the GCN shop at shop.globalcyclingnetwork.com. And now, for another great video, how about clicking just down here?